because the hottest fire takes the hardest heat. With this note, I would like to start our panel discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our first panel member, Ms. Kanisha Raina from IBM.
Our chief guest with flowers.
Thank you, sir. May we now call upon Himanshu Sharma, student manager, BIMHRD, to introduce Ms. Kanisha Raina.
Good evening, esteemed dignitaries and my fellow student managers. I'm highly honored to introduce a towering personality who has climbed the ladder of corporate success, an IBMer, Mrs. Kanisha Raina, talent partner, research, cloud, commerce, security, analytics, and systems, Asia Pacific. In her current role, she partners with the business and HR leaders in developing the workforce strategy, design programs, project management, and execution of those programs by working closely with each of the talent pillars. Nominated in the list of Witty Parrot as one of the top 100 HR influencers to follow on Twitter globally. Kanisha Ma'am has also won the very prestigious Future Emerging HR Leader Award given by People Matters magazine for 2015. She completed her engineering from Bhopal University, followed by an MBA from SIBM Pune. Ma'am, we are highly honored to welcome you.
I'd like to delightfully welcome our next panel member, Mr. Sushant Bhushan from BMC Software.
Our chief guest with flowers.
Thank you, sir. May we now call upon Shashank Pandey, student manager, BIM and HRD, to introduce Mr. Shashank Bhushan.
Good evening to all of you. I, Shashank Pandey, student manager, Balaji Institute of Management and Human Resources Department, is so pleased to be with you all this evening and to have the chance of introducing our guest speaker today, Mr. Sushant Bhushan. Sir is presently working as a Area Vice President, HR, APAC and CEO India, BMC Software India Private Limited since 2010. Prior to this, Sir had also worked with companies like IBM India Private Limited, ITC Infotech, Tavender Process and DPL Limited. Sir has done his MSW, that is Master in Social Work, in Human Resource from Institute of Social Science from Agra in 1994. Sir had an experience of over 20 years in HR. He had worked across the wide spectrum of industries like media and entertainment, consumer electronics, engineering and information technology, and have had an in-depth exposure to almost all the areas of human resource, the focus in being a HR generalist. His specialties in business HR and M&A, leadership development, and executive coaching, etc. Sir, in last, now I would like to request you to please address the panel and the student manager. Thank you.
Let's raise a hearty welcome to our next panel member, Ms. Neetu Bala Raina from Tieto.
I'd like to call upon Professor D.S. Kadam, Director, Projects and Alumni Affairs, to felicitate our chief guest with flowers.
Good evening to one and all present here. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome our guest, Ms. Neetu Bala Raina, Global HR Partner in Tieto. She has been earlier associated with BMC Software, Sears Holding Corporations, and Nielsoft Limited. She has studied HR and Organizational Behavior from the University of Pune. Ma'am has also done executive coaching by Neuro Leadership Group. She has done certification in Emotional Intelligence and 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. She is Master Facilitator from PLI Certified by USA and L&D Specialist. She possesses proven expertise in building talent capabilities across levels and have been seamlessly coaching leaders in developing talent pipelines to cater to the critical business needs and customer expectations. Ma'am, looking forward for an interactive session. Thank you.
Mr. Kunjal Kmadar from Polaris.
I'd like to call upon Dr. G. Gopal Krishnan, Director, BIMHRD, to felicitate our chief guest with a bouquet.
Senior Manager, Talent Digital and Social Engagement at Polaris Consulting and Services Limited. Sir has earlier been associated with companies like WNS Global Services, QNX and KP Gemini. Sir has done PGC HRM from XLRI Jamshedpur and has an experience of more than 10 years in IT recruitment. Sir is a contributor and blogger in India HR Live. Sir, we all are looking forward for an interactive session with you.
Let's get started with the panel discussion. The theme of the discussion is engaging and attracting millionaire workforces. I'd like to call upon Ms. Kanisha Raina to moderate and commence the panel discussion. Ma'am, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, wow. Okay. Houston, is there a problem? Apollo, Houston, check 1, 2, 3. Okay, I feel as if I'm like in one of those NASA labs and waiting for the rocket to get launched. This is really cool. I don't think I've ever worn something like this. I'm really uncomfortable. Engaging millennials. Okay, we picked up a really cool topic because we've got very cool people out here as the audience. So let me kind of tell you what millennials are. So I'm not giving like a big definition. Simply put, the way the world sees it, millennials is the name given to anyone and everyone who's born between the years of 1980 to 1996. Okay, so just by a show of hands, how many of you are born between 1980 to 1996?
Everybody.
Now this panel discussion is for you. Okay, so hear up, because we're going to talk about you, we'll call you names, we'll talk about how good or bad or nasty or nice you guys are. And we're also going to talk about what our organizations doing today to attract people such as you and in that age range, okay? And what are we doing not just to attract them, but to ensure that they are retained and engaged in our organizations. So the people that you see on the panel today, we couldn't have picked a better lot, because between the three of them, the kind of experience that they have, one from working with millennials and second from devising strategies for millennials, they would be the right people to talk about this topic. Now, how many of you are from HR? Okay. So from HR, the way I would want you to look at this panel is, you need to keep listening in for all those strategies. But okay, here's what these organizations are doing, because you will be a part of the group that will be working very closely with the business to design such strategies, to tell them, here's what are the best practices, let's do this. For those of you who are in marketing, I'm guessing you, the rest of you are marketing, and finance, maybe in operations? Okay. All right. Why is operations always like, operations like, how can you forget operations? okay, alright. So, non-HR, it's an HR week, so I can take that liberty. So those of you who are not in HR, still listen up, and I'll tell you why. Because the workforce that we're talking about will be your end customers. Okay, those of you who are into marketing will go and sell to these people. You need to know how they behave. They are, well, a good number of them who are consumers are the same age range as you. So I kind of made my notes on a smartphone, like, you know, you will be doing. How many of you are you allowed to use smartphones?
No.
Saying that loudly won't help your cause, you still have to. But yeah, as in, the moment you're out, what you'd realize is that our organizations today are so focused on technology, and all four of us work for technology companies, and the kind of work that you're doing in order to get to all of you is a lot got to do with the smartphones. So what I thought was, since, coincidentally, some of us happen to be older millennials, yes, still millennials, but older millennials, we decided to use a little bit of technology today to kind of ensure that there's a smooth flow of questions. When this whole millennial concept of when generations change, there's always this research work, a lot of consulting organizations that come into the picture and say, hey, you know what, I will tell you how to deal with these. Right, we've been talking about how consulting companies have made a moolah over creating these generational differences and telling us more about it. So one of the organizations which did a very good job in telling us who are these millennials, what do they want, is Gallup. Have you heard of the company?
Yes.
Yeah? So Gallup does a lot of research with this, and I will talk about some stats and figures which Gallup put forth about millennials. The second group that did some millennial surveys was Deloitte. So I'll talk about a few statistics from there as well. Goldman Sachs and other companies have also, and Happy Inc. has also done some work around it. Now let's talk about Gallup first before we kind of move on to our panel members and talk about why are we talking about this today. We are closing this three-day meet that you had with a very significant topic, because it's relevant to each and every one of you, whether you are in HR or not. And when Gallup did this survey, it came up with these top six items where they're talking about millennials, and they're saying, here's how millennials work. So the research that they did in 2015 talked about how millennials want to work and live. And they said, here are the top six. Millennials don't just work for a paycheck. It's got to be much more than that. Millennials are not pursuing job satisfaction. They need a wholesome life. And I'm quite sure a lot of you, as you go into the jobs, you will also start seeing similar things. That it's not just, you want to go for that trip as well with your friends. You want to do something else with your life as well. Millennials don't want bosses. They want coaches. They don't like to be told. They would rather have somebody coach them. Millennials don't want annual reviews, they want ongoing conversations. Millennials don't want to fix what kind of work will come to them. And it's not just my job, it's my life. That's the attitude with which millennials go. And with that, I'll move on to our panel members. I've got Shashank here, who's joined us from BMC. Their organization has very recently won a very significant award on engaging the millennials in the Zone of Confluence. It's a very big award because they've finally, I think, kind of cracked the code. So why don't you tell us, why do you feel this is a relevant topic for today?
Why is it relevant? I think simply because all of you are very rich, as Kanisha has put. And whether you're going to be working for the previous generation or you will be nursing the generations to come, all of you need to understand the nuances of what's leaving the generation work first of all and how you're going to be successful in your time to come. So this topic, therefore, from my perspective, is extremely important.
And Neetu, how about you? As in Tieto, it's one of the MNCs in technology school, some great work. What about you? What do you see? Do you also agree with Shashank as to the relevance of the topic today?
Indeed a very relevant topic. You know, in Tieto, we have 75% of our population is basically millennials. So that again makes it all the more interesting for me also because, you know, besides us as HR and management, you know, understanding millennials and what their aspirations are, what are the skills that they develop in millennials, it's also important for students to understand, you know, the landscape they are in.
Okay.
I think it's indeed a very relevant topic.
Sure. Kunjal, you've been doing a lot of social hiring, right? So Kunjal is our expert in so hiring also has changed, but we'll talk a little bit about that a little later. But Kunjal, what about you? What is your perspective on the topic today?
Very interesting topic. Before that, I'd just like to ask one question to the audience, including the panel. How many of you check your phones the first thing when you wake up in the morning? Before you go to sleep? After you go to sleep? You wake up again, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so yes, this is the kind of generation that we are expecting, including me. So yes, very relevant topic, and also the challenge with these generation and the other generation, because they'll be reporting to the other generation, right? So the idea is to ensure that there's the right balance. They have too much information freely available to them. But the problem with them is they don't know how to filter it. So this is what something maybe during the panel discussion we would also try to address. Maybe some tips, tricks that we'd like to give you guys that will definitely help you all.
Thank you so much, Kunjal. You know, you mentioned about, you know, how much everybody is on social today, right? And research actually shows that 93% of the millennials today are hooked to information technology, are hooked to social media. In fact, that's the place they get most of their information from. And the rest, if you look at past days, you know, when we were where you are, we used to read newspapers, right, to get information. Economic Times was a mandatory newspaper to read. But today, you will read everything on an app. You don't have to buy that tangible newspaper. Of course, I think you guys will have to, since you don't have, that's not allowed in college, but the moment you come out, you use apps, right? The moment you go home, that's what you kind of look at. And that brings me to this question that previously, the kind of generation that we were attracting, our strategies are quite different, right? You put out an ad in the newspaper and people come and apply. But today that entire generation has changed. They don't, how many of you by choice would look at a newspaper if it was not mandated by college? The professors are not allowed to look at the back. Not any. How many of you would by choice and not read, you know, the same thing on an app? If you had a choice between a smartphone and a newspaper, what would you pick? How many of you would pick a smartphone? Okay, and the rest I'm guessing. So that's the question. So today, how do you see that hiring landscape change? How do you see your strategies change?
Yeah, very interesting question, and also I have some data for this. Today, 47% of workers were born after 1980. That is including every one of you. And by 2025, there will be more than 75 workers who are social media generation. So this is the kind of population that we are expecting. And again, we move a long way from newspaper ads to Facebook hiring. I see a lot of success of a lot of companies having a Facebook specific dedicated page. How many of you are following any company on Facebook? Right, so there are a lot of activities, just like your college has activities, right? Cultural festivals, awards, rewards. The same concept companies are trying to adapt to attract that kind of generation, that kind of millennial population that we are seeing. We have seen a lot of progress in terms of hiring through social media. So one advice would be just ensure that you're active and you follow the organizations, right, on social media, because they are very active and that's the place where people like to go. And also, we've seen a lot of trend in terms of people not going on a careers website to know more about the organization. They go on a LinkedIn page or a Glassdoor page. So that's the kind of information that they are getting freely available. I mean, maybe 10 years, 12 years back, if you ask me, we did not have that kind of information in hand, right? We used to ask our uncles and aunts, how's this organization?
Yeah. Do you have a relative in that company?
Exactly.
That is like the common question to us.
Exactly. So it's good, in a way, for organizations to also make that shift, because that's the way the industry is moving. We can't have that traditional strategies working again on the kind of population that we are hiring. So yes, positive change, but the only challenge is that to ensure that you follow the right organizations, you follow them actively on social media, because you have the access very much freely available with you.
Thank you so much. Attracting is one bit. The other significant part is, once they're in your company, right, you've got to retain them, and you've got to engage them. In fact, statistics say that, I'm going to keep talking about statistics because that's research, right? That about 21% of the people would leave the current organizations in a few years by 2020. That they're already thinking about doing that. And those who leave, and about 27% leave within a year's time. And the reason, the core reason that they leave is that they feel that the organization has not done enough for them. So that engagement piece is missing. But your company, as I said earlier, seems to have cracked the code. So how did you go about developing the strategy to engage millennials?
Kanisha, I think this is your, I don't think anyone really cracked the code. But it would be very hard to crack the code in an economy which is still growing. And so the way things have worked for us and what we're doing is trying to find the balance between the two generations which are at work. Almost if we were to look at the Gen X and the millennials, it forms about 67 to 70% of our workforce. So the trick is not to find engagement model for a particular generation, because a generation cannot exist without its leaders. The millennials need the Gen X for mentoring and coaching and letting them know how things operate. And the Gen X needs it because this generation is the digital native digital, or whatever you say that. And there's a lot of learning, the reverse coaching that each of the generations get. So I think what we have tried to do is evolve the strategies which bring the two generations together and help them see value. And if I would just take that argument forward, I also feel that sometimes there is a lot of generational talk, which is a work of a lot of consulting companies. Like you talked about, they're generating a lot of dollars out of it. But fact remains that each generation, a new generation is always smarter than the previous one, because the newer generation has a wealth of knowledge available to them at the fingertips, which is the work of the previous.
Sure.
And therefore, there's a strong need to nurture both these generations at the same time. So for BMC, for example, there are three things that we really call out as a tenet. Great technology means that you work on cutting-edge technologies, future-oriented technologies, and so on. Social relevance, and I think that's where this generation identifies themselves very much, is be connected to the community that we work with and giving back. And third is that it has to be a fun place to work. Now, by the way, if you look at it and think about it a little bit objectively, the previous generation is not going to be averse.
Yeah.
I raise my hand when you ask this question that, do I, you know, look at the phone, the first thing, the last thing, even when I wake up in the night. So, you know, the line between the generation is not that sharp as sometimes as it is. So there's a lot of difference.
That's true. In fact, one of the things that we've started to do even in IBM is that these new millennials, such as yourself, who come into the company, we give them some projects which are more about reverse mentoring. Reverse mentoring means, instead of somebody senior teaching you something, you teach them something back. So
That's the important part, and that, and we've kind of made these projects. So they do things like T3 talk, which means they will pick up some technology and they will do these sessions for all the senior leaders to tell them how this works. So I think our organizations are also gearing towards millennials teaching, you know, the senior staff something. Yeah. And from that, you know, one of the things that is different today, and I think a lot of you in HR, a lot of times we are approached asking, talk about global HR. Okay, what's global HR? And who are our, you know, the HR strategies are basically a reflection of who is your population, who is your employer. So today, as per Deloitte, what they say is that they interviewed 7,700 employees across 29 countries. And the resultant surveys were not different. But what do you think, is it being in Tieto and the MNC culture, do you see that the millennials in, say, Finland are different from the millennials in India? Do you see a difference anywhere?
So how are the similar, let me, you know, quickly tell you about it. So I see that, you know, all of them look for, first is contribution. So they really want to understand, you know, how are they contributing in achieving, you know, the vision of the team or the goals of the team. Second is connect. Connect is very important to them globally. So when I say connect, I'm talking about collaboration, I'm talking about communication, and I'm really so happy to see that, you know, they really proactively seek feedback, and I have seen that, you know, everywhere globally, even in India, the millennials that we have, you know, they also want to have feedback. Then the first is about credibility. So credibility of the leadership, you know, that is one of the primary sources of inspiration to them. So, you know, having talked about these three C's, I think millennials, the expectations that they have globally are, you know, similar. Now, how are they different? You know, I would like to quickly tell you about an incident. I was, you know, a year back in Helsinki for this HR summit, and there is this young lady, you know, must be 30 plus, hardly 30 plus. So she came, she walked up to me and she asked me that, you know, she recently graduated from London, and she was amazed to see that there are so many Indian students, you know, who have high aspirations. They're so diligent. So she wanted, you know, she asked me that, you know, what is it about? So, you know, when I interact with them, you know, and when they learn that I'm an Indian, they often talk about India's population, so much noise, you know, so many people on the road. So we had those conversations also. So I told her, you know, with 1.25 million population that you often keep asking me, you know, several questions about, I would attribute that to that, to our population. So she was a little surprised, and, you know, I said, I told her, I said, see, you know, we have in India, we have by the, you know, large population, we also have a large number of in comparison to the opportunities that we have. So that, you know, that fuels fire in the belly. And moreover, like, you know, their government gives them, you know, some free facilities and benefits. But in India, if you almost for every benefit and, you know, service that you desire for, you really have to work hard for. And that actually, you know, impacts the aspiration levels. And, you know, she said, oh, I already get that. So in my opinion, you know, millennials, at least that's my observation, that has been my observation based on my interactions with the talents globally. I'm really so proud of millennials, you know, we have in India. I'm very proud of them because you know, the fire in the belly that they have, the competitive spirit and drive that they have, that is so amazing. That in my opinion, you know, you can just crack the first of the competition in any part of the world. So in that way, I think millennials in India are really amazing, you know, and they are different in that sense.
True. I think that's a fair point, and I think that goes to all of you sitting here as well. So you're supposed to be the best of the lot, and I'm hoping that there's a lot of fire in their bellies as well, and that they push forward with that. So thank you so much. And you know, you talked about you know, how it's common in such certain ways. How, in fact, for those of you who, all of you are on Facebook, right?
Yes.
Okay. How many of you are on Twitter? That's a significant group. How many of you are on LinkedIn? All of you are on Facebook? Show of hands. How many of you are on Facebook? And I'm quite sure, how many of you have friends outside of India? Do you see them very different from you? Except don't look at the locations they're in. But do you see them as very different from you? Right? And maybe the circumstances and the world, and that's what she was talking about. The kind of competition you have here, I'm just looking at the room, right? You're in a B school in perhaps the same year, across four colleges. Is this four colleges or just one?
Four
colleges. Look at the competition you have right here. And the amount of hard work that perhaps you here, one of you is doing here, that kind of hard work, you wouldn't really see in many other parts of the world. Perhaps China, but that's perhaps the only other example.
Exactly, because you know, like I was talking about Europe, I see that you know, they have, there in fact they have a different challenge. So attracting Y generation there remains a challenge, it does. But you know, opportunities are not limited for them. So that also sort of, that apparently tends to impact your aspiration levels. But in India, you know, we have, you know, so many competitors and the opportunities are not so many. So, you know, in comparison to the European Y generation that I see, our Indian Y generation, you know, they seem to be more competitive or if not competitive, but I must say that they are really diligent. They are really diligent.
If I could add, I think what is common between the millennials in India versus anywhere else is the mindset, is the attitude. Is the kind of common urban culture that is there. It is not so different between, you know, folks in different countries.
Right.
So these guys are listening to the same music, possibly watching the same kind of YouTube videos, you know, going on to the same social media, have friends all over the world who possibly they have not even seen,
right.
And but they interact with them very, very regularly. So the outlook of this generation is not so global, mm-hmm. And I think that is the fundamental difference between this generation. The outlook is not more. The sense of awe that perhaps my generation has with somebody outside of India, because he may not be there.
Yeah. In fact, to your point, we had a very small batch of people join us in IBM in Asia very recently. And you know, they were just talking about somebody, and they kept saying superwoman. And then they said YouTube. So I just genuinely asked them, I said, so who's what superwoman, right? And how many of you know who Superwoman is, right? And she's a YouTube star. She's like one of the top 10 most watched YouTube stars. And her following is across the board. And she is basically from an Indian descent, but born and brought up in Canada. I think brought up in Canada, born in India. But everybody watches the video, and I see, and I look at the comments, and I'm so intrigued by the comments. That people from across the globe, kids from across the globe relate to it. Oh, my mom says that too. You wouldn't have heard that, you know, when we were maybe her age. You wouldn't have heard that. Somebody who's like an Indian mother is so different from a, you know, say a Russian mother, an American mother. But now you see that that's also changed. The way they're interacting at home, it's, as you said, the music that they're hearing is so similar. So that way, it's, I think, it's a level playing field.
Just an addition, you know, another observation that I have is that, you know, the acceptance levels that this generation has for diversity is really amazing.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't think so it was, you know, a decade back like this. It was.
And there's a lot less, and I don't know if, you know, at least stats say that, and we've seen that in our, you know, employees as well. Lot less politically motivated, lot less religiously motivated,
they're far more open to that kind of diversity as well, as in not just gender diversity, but diversity in terms of religion, politics, far more indifferent also to politics.
It's really interesting now because of some interventions that, you know, I had driven in the recent past. So we have been talking about, you know, developing a global mindset. Now, so we were talking about this because we have an intervention for Y generation called Insights. So we have different programs. So there we actually, you know, while discussing, we actually started to think that do we really need one module called, you know, developing mindset for the Y generation or for the X generation? Because the acceptance, like I said, you know, their acceptance levels to diversity is far, far better. So they already have a global mindset. I think it's more about giving them a global exposure. So,
and since you talked about that initiative, let's talk about a few initiatives in our organizations that we're doing to engage with millennials and to kind of take them to their actual, you know, competencies, to help them reach their potential. So, Sushant, how about you, Kunjal?
Yeah, in terms of engaging with them, again, we try to understand the kind of communications that they like, right? So we cannot have that traditional approach to communicate with the millennials. So we have this great initiative in Brazil. How many of you heard Yammer?
Yammer?
Few of them? Okay. Yammer is nothing but Facebook 2.0. So it's just your Facebook for your internal communication within the organization. So that's one of the ways where we are trying to communicate them to Yammer, because they can relate to it very easily, because it's just like Facebook, where you have to put your status updates, you can add photos, you can add images, you can join groups, you can create groups, right? So something that they are already been aware of. The same thing has been copied in terms of workplace also, where you can communicate to them in their same language. That is one of the initiatives that we are trying, because that's the language that they understand. I cannot just send them a brochure and then ask them to read it. It's very boring and dull, right? So that's one of the initiatives. And again, there are a lot of WhatsApp groups. How many of you are part of minimum 10 WhatsApp groups?
20?
Yeah,
20. So yes, again, the thing that I'm trying to say is, again, there was a research done recently from one of the organizations, the top 10 active social channels that the Indians use, top 5 are messengers. So this is something that we as organization should also take notice of and also communicate to you guys or the population in that language, because they understand it very easily.
You generated a lot of interest the moment you said WhatsApp. Like, WhatsApp, I'm going to go back and get on to it. I don't know how many messages pending. Yeah, but a lot of organizations today, we actually do our work on WhatsApp. There's like teams of WhatsApp, all the communication is happening through that. How about does it happen in your business?
So yeah, of course. I think they have a lot of informal channels of communication, and WhatsApp is one of the most popular ones. Snapchat is another one that a lot of people are using. I go a little, you know, off the HR piece. We are also seeing that this generation works different. You know, the expectation of physical space itself is different. I'm very surprised seeing all of you speak it. So, you know, with so much of patience here, with your suits on, you know, and no smartphones, right? You know, so no distractions there. But typically, the millennials are supposed to be working, you know, having expectations to be able to work from anywhere, work in any manner as possible. So my 10-year-old son, if he has to write, he will hardly sit on a chair and be able to write. He will be lying down with writing, or he'll be on an iPad and lying upside down with his feet up. And so when you design a new office, we actually took into consideration that you're building it for the next generation. And therefore, our office has all kinds of weird configurations of seating. You know, there are loungers, there are beanbags, and there are, you know, we used to have maybe about 50 or 60 meeting rooms in a previous office. We have about 350 meeting places in a new office. Because, you know, meeting does not require any longer than a new paradigm, a room. All you need is a place where two people can. And it could be a pantry area, it could be a corner in the office, or it could be what we call a cave, it could be the cafeteria. All you need is a technological support of Wi-Fi being available. We in fact have even set up video conferencing facilities right in the middle of the floor, in the open. We don't have cabins any longer, everybody sees an email. And we find that people are doing video conference there, and there's right next to him another person sitting and doing his coding. And they're not bothered.
Yeah.
So, you know, the entire paradigm of working has also changed. And organizations are, you know, really getting on to it very fast, because now when you build facilities, you're building it for the next 10, 15, 20 years, when this generation will be
work. True. In fact, you know, now in IBM, one of the things that we do now is, for example, in my case, I work, I'm responsible for the Asia-Pacific piece, which means that I've got teams across. There are people I'm working with for years, I've never met them. Okay, I've never met them in person, I've never seen them physically in front of me. Like, there are people, I just recently, we had an HR conference, I met them after 10 years. They're very good friends of mine, but I've never seen them, I've never met them. Because the technology is so strong, social media is so strong, because you're connected on Facebook, so I see their vacation pictures, and we comment on each other, and everything is through video conferences, so we actually speak on videos, we've seen each other. WhatsApp is so strong, other technology is so strong, that it kind of helps build the relations without really being in front of them. And for the millennials, it's so natural. So like your office, IBM is a century old company, and now we've actually taken on this project of changing the way, you know, our offices look, because our offices look really old. You'd think you'd enter into a museum in some of those places. And now if you know, the way they're changing, there are no cubicles. They're just seating, and they're just beanbags lying around. Go take, connect your laptop or your Mac to anything and go ahead. Our salespeople, you know, your marketing guys out here would be interested in this. Every sales guy has an iPad. That's how they sell. Okay, they have all of the stats, all the data right in front of them. You enter into our facilities where you want to see what research we are doing, and you would think that you entered into the Iron Man next movie. Because everything looks like that, right? And everything is more visual. Everything is more, you're in front of you. It's not theory, it's not books. Like when I was studying computers, my first year in my class, I was in school, when I studied a computer, was that I was supposed to sit in front of a computer, draw the computer. I'm not kidding you. Okay? Draw the ALU, draw the keyboard, draw the screen. I never got to touch the computer for freaking 1 year. It was only when they thought I could draw the computer well, for some strange reason, that they thought I could operate on the computer. I made my first programming in code on paper, never trying it on the computer. See the world it's changed. So, yeah, you're very, very lucky. But I think they're going to say that to their next generations as well. How about you, as in, what other things, apart from the initiative, you just insights that you told us, that we are doing in Tieto?
So, you know, like I said, somewhere, you know, I believe that Y generation has a global mindset in so many ways. So, I think it's what we discussed, you know, with my global teams first, that, you know, how do we give them a global exposure? Because we have different interventions which were actually executed, you know, at the country level. So we thought of coming up with, you know, one another intervention. We named it iGrow. So this iGrow is a global intervention. It is basically for the Y generation, wherein, you know, we have different modules based on the outcomes of earlier intervention insights that I talked about. What do they exactly want to achieve? What are their aspirations? So they're very clear. You know, they are very very clear that, you know, this is what I want to learn. These are my aspirations. And they're very assertive also. So iGrow basically, it focuses on giving them exposure at a global level. So we have different modules, right from, you know, working in a complex matrix organization, having leadership conversations. So we have different modules which, you know, are covered under this program, and we ensure that, you know, these programs are basically every year. These are, you know, held in different locations. You know, so last we had Stockholm. Before that we had it in Helsinki. So we are planning to have it in Prague, in Czech. So you know, that really the feedback that we have gotten is that, you know, this travel to different places, understanding the culture, looking at things from altogether a different set of glasses. You know, because you are interacting with people, you know, who are different. So, you know, in fact, I was so proud, you know, when one of the Y, you know, Gen employees said that, you know, Neetu, I know that, you know, we are different as Indians, and we are different as Indians. But there was a time, you know, when he was basically, you know, referring to his parents' generation, where, you know, being different is not acceptable. But today, you know, it's just that you are different, I am different.
what is important is that, you know, this difference is respected. So I see that that already exists there. And then there are, you know, these different modules that I talked about which we covered. And it has been so far a great experience, and we have received great feedback from the leadership team also. So IGRO has been one of our, you know, fantastic interventions in this space, and it's going pretty well.
So I think clearly you can see that the organizations are doing a whole lot to attract you all, to engage you all. So you are stepping into a world where we look at the possible or the future employees and we make our strategy based on them. Gone are the days when here was the company, here were its values, here is what happens here. You go inside and you change yourself to fit into the existing structure. The paradigm is changing in a very good way. And you seem to be perfect. That's what the suggestion is, isn't it? You're a good version of yourself. But if I were to ask each one of you, and this is really my last question, if I were to ask each one of you, what would be your suggestion to all of them? Not just, so to the HR folks, is people who are going to come in and join our teams, and handle such strategies. To those of them who are not HR, but who will be working alongside millennials and Generation X, what would be your suggestion to them? So let me start from you, Kunjal.
Sure, again, a couple of things. One is do a lot of research, be it any generation or be it any marketing, HR or operations. You have all the facilities in the world to do a lot of research, be active socially, connect with a lot of influencers, connect with a lot of leaders online. Today is very easy to approach a CEO or a VP HR or any head of any department. Don't obviously send him a Facebook request. Don't do that. Send him a LinkedIn invite or a Twitter, follow them. It's so very easy for you to get a lot of information. So don't think yourself that you cannot connect with them. Obviously, we also discussed that you are different, you are unique. So do showcase that out through your LinkedIn profiles or through your... How many of you blog over here? Yeah, that is one of the areas that definitely I see a lot of organizations also showing some interest in talent, right? Who blog. The idea of blogging is nothing but you're showing to the world what you are good at, what are your thoughts. So as a leader or as someone who's hiring, I would definitely like to know something beyond your typical resume, right? So these are some of the, one is networking, one is blogging, and one is always being connected with the trends via research that you do. So these are some of the tips, tricks that definitely I would like to give you guys.
How about you?
So, you know, I have two solutions based on my heart-to-heart conversations that I have had with, you know, I think n number of, you know, Y-Gen teams. We were driving those interventions. One is that, you are receptive to feedback. At least you ask, you know, for the feedback. You assert it. But it's very important to have the ability to deal with gray shapes. Because, you know, every time you won't get things in black and white. And especially if you are, you know, in the corporate landscape and, you know, many of you may even follow the technical track or management track. But then, you know, leadership quality remains common, you know, in any career track, I would say. And then the second suggestion is, I place a lot of emphasis on emotional intelligence. So please, you know, understand your emotional framework. Your emotional framework is not going to remain same at every stage of your life, at every stage of your career also. So once you have understood your emotional framework, you have control over your emotions. You actually, you know, emit positive emotions, and what you absorb is also positive. You know, there is a beautiful saying I had read somewhere that we all take a little bit of each other, from each other, everywhere we go. So, you know, it's such a beautiful thing, because you meet 100 people and there is some bit of each other that you're going to carry along. But the choice is yours. What are you going to carry along? Are you carrying along, you know, positive emotions or negative emotions? Whatever you feed, you are going to, you know, build that within you. So I think that's also very important. Just these two things.
Thank you so much.
How
about you?
I'll be very vague suggestions. Like you said, you know, these installations are not like to be told.
Yeah.
But I would just say two things, and I'll take a little bit longer to say them. One is, don't get too overawed by so much of generational talk. You are different for sure, but each generation is different from the previous. Each new generation, like I said earlier, is smarter than the previous one, simply because there's a lot more information, a lot more knowledge that will become available. And therefore, be cognizant of that. So it is not about whether it is better or worse. It is about, it is different, respect, and learn is the one thing I do. The second would be, and I'll give a little bit of analogy. Supposing you all had slept off and woken up in 1740, the year 1740. And from that time, when you wake up 250 years later, in say 1990, how would you feel? You would feel shocked that, you know, you were riding horses there, and now you're riding in 1990, you know, on cars and motorbikes, and had trucker roads and houses, etc. Now, if you had slept off in 1740 and woken up in, say, 1600, would there have been a shock, an element of shock? I don't think so, because you were still relatively the same era. You were still riding horses, you were still had roads which are not very pakka, or houses were like that, or eating habits were like that. But if you had, say, slept off in 1740 and you had woken up during the Stone Age, would there have been a shock?
Yes.
It's about 2,500 years back. There would have been a massive shock. Now, if you had slept off in 1990, you know, remember, 1990, India was still a closed economy. And you had woken up in 2015, you would have been shocked?
Yes.
The economy has opened up, and you know, now you can go to a counter and buy dollars. You know, you wouldn't have done that in 1990, even 95 for that matter. Or today we are talking about autonomous cars. You know, cars which will be driven by themselves. Today we are talking about jobs and industries which did not exist 20 years back. Now, what I'm trying to say is that between 1740 and 1990, it took 250 years for one major change to happen. The previous change happened in about 2500 years. And the change that is happening now has happened in about 25 years. The next change will happen in the next 5 years. So the change is happening a lot faster than it has ever happened in the history of man. And you guys are sitting right in the center of it. And so the complexity that you'll have to deal with will come with very rapid changes. And that is going to be a challenge. That is going to be a challenge of major adaptation to be done very, very quickly. You know, each generation tells the previous generation, you don't get it. You know, things have changed.
Yeah.
Right?
How many of you hear it from your parents?
Or you take your parents, you know, you tell your parents, you don't understand it.
Yeah.
The fact is that your younger brother and sisters, who are maybe 3, 4, 5 years younger than you, will be telling you the same. Because they are seeing the world, or they will see the world differently in a much shorter time. And that is something that you have to learn.
Absolutely, absolutely, I'll agree. And my two cents are this, for all of you in HR, go up and read up on these articles on engaging millennials. And the reason why I'm asking you to do that is because, well, your Facebook time is closed, so start preparing. And secondly, for you, the more important piece is research and investigation on these things is very important. Because a lot of best practices get shared. You may not agree with all of them, but you must know all of them. Because your competition, as she said, fire in the belly, your competition today would be doing the same across the globe. Alright? And my second suggestion to all of you, and I'm going to say that for placements again because that portion is coming in. Most of our organizations today, almost all of the technology companies today, are on some social media channels. For example, LinkedIn. For example, Facebook. Do ensure that you're following, because when the same company comes to your campus, they would expect you to have done that research. It's not anymore, like for example, if I tell you, okay, now, ask me a question. And if you ask me a question, which is first line on my LinkedIn profile of my organization, clearly you haven't researched. So if those of you, and not just technology companies, every possible company has. So today one of the things that you must do when you go back and, you know, I'm quite sure some of you are waiting to go check that one message on your WhatsApp. Pick up, install LinkedIn. Okay, go follow the companies. All of you have your dream companies?
Yes, sir.
Right? You have your dream companies? Go go follow your dream companies. And not just on LinkedIn, where they themselves are talking about, you know, their own companies. Also go to Glassdoor. Okay, and I personally think Glassdoor is a fantastic channel. You want to really know the truth about a company? Go to Glassdoor. And you must do this as you're lining up for your placements. Because we also will come to know, you know, through you. And then, if you want to ask questions to all of us, post this panel discussion, all of us are on Twitter. Each one of us. So you can actually follow us on Twitter, read our blogs, ask us questions, and trust me, since I have seen the turnaround times for everyone, you will get your answers fairly quickly. Alright? And we'll be able to connect you with the you know, almost all of our teams are on Twitter today. So we can connect you to the right folks. But use it. It will all depend on you. On whether you are leveraging it and using it or not. With that, I think my questions are done. Let me just pause a little. Are there any questions which you have for us which you think we haven't answered so far?
Good evening, panel members. My question is over to all of you. There were and there will be misfits type of people in every generation, like Steve Jobs and those who are highly creative, awesome, like that. And organizations want their employees to work in a team, in a cooperative manner.
It's okay, I think you're gearing up to a very good question. I like where his mind is going.
So, organization want their employees to work in a cooperative manner. And misfits have their own way of approaching the pattern and achieving their goals. So, from an HR's perspective, how do you deal with those kind of people in your company? So that's my question.
Alright, who wants to go first for this?
You know, so I'll take that, and I don't know whether I have a complete answer for the question there. You know, misfits have existed always. Bill Gates was a misfit, Steve Jobs was a misfit, and there are stories of misfits in India as well, who have made lives big, as you well know. But bear in mind that there are far many more misfits that you have not heard of. So one is that it's important for you to understand your own area of strength. It is very important for you to understand where your organization is headed from. And make an early assessment where there is a fitment for you with that organization or with that piece, that career trajectory that you've chosen. The problem happens when the organization chooses to decide, you know, whether you are a fit or a misfit. I would rather have me or you or anybody else decide whether do I fit in this or not. And then, so Steve Jobs, which was a misfit, he identified himself to a misfit and he created an organization that aligned with himself and his strengths. So I would rather look at it from the perspective of the individual rather than the organization giving you. Because the organization is always going to be large and anybody who does not align will feel being thrown out one way or the other.
In fact, you know, sometime back what happened is that IBM realized that we have too many misfits. In fact, if you really think about it, IBM is an organization full of misfits. Because all of us feel like a misfit, right? As in, remember your first day in college when you came here to Balaji. And you didn't know, like you knew this one-off person from your location, but you really didn't know. And you don't know whether you're going to make friends, you don't know whether you're going to like your classes, you don't even know whether you like your stream. And everybody internally is feeling like a misfit. And maybe this is, you're not sure. And I didn't realize that, you know, everybody is unique in a way, so they might feel like a misfit. And one of our core principles today is something called treasuring wild ducks. Wild ducks are those people who don't follow pattern. Okay? Who are different from the rest of the group. And it's a part of our value system that those are the people whom you really have to take care of. Because they would need that extra assurance. In fact, if I could just take a little bit of time, there was this one story, it was very popular. Walt Disney is one of IBM's clients. And when we were working with this meet, we were putting forth some proposal for them, and it just wasn't working. There was a new summer intern who had just joined us, and he had an idea. And he told his idea to the manager. The manager said, look, I don't think, I know these guys, I don't think it's going to work. The guy from Disney overheard that conversation and said, let me hear the guy out. And the proposal this guy had was finally the idea that Disney Corporation took on, and it got us a lot of moolah, right? And that, and there are so many more examples like that in all companies, not just my name. So today, you are very lucky because you are entering into a time when being a misfit also is absolutely all right. It's absolutely okay. So you, honestly, those of you who think like that, you know, trust me, you're going to have a good time. Any other questions?
Ma'am, here. I am Chetna from PMNHR batch from Bimhrd. As you said that in the discussion that the strategies you plan are according to our generation, our thinking. But I want to ask that does not increase or decrease the productivity or does it affect the productivity? Like this generation is not more about thinking much. We just do it like that. So does it decrease the productivity or affect the development of the organization?
So what Neetu was saying about the fire and rebellion. So I'll just give an example of how BMC operates. The way we work, our office setup is such, you could come in the office at 6 in the morning or 9 in the morning or 11 in the morning, go straight away to the recreation area, start playing pool. There would be a Zumba session in the afternoon, you could go do your Zumba, you are sweating, you go shower and come back to work. Even end of expectation is that you will manage the output and productivity that is expected of. The way you do it, the organizations are giving you a lot more liberty to do it. You know, whether you want to work on your desk, you want to go and sit in a cave, or you want to sit on a lounger. Ultimately, as adults, and to Neetu's point, with the fire and rally that you have, and that you want to succeed, you want to compete against your global competitors, and not just your, you know, someone who's sitting next to you. You find ways to production. And I think organizations are far more confident of the generation that the delivery will really happen, irrespective of, you know, differences and difference of ways of doing.
Yeah. And I think not thinking much is not a generational thing. It is an age thing. Like all of us that age have done exactly that. As we just did things that happened. The things were happening to us. You know, for a very long time, Ganesh. In fact, you, I'm sure a good number of you chose your graduation subject. You know, in my day, it was if you got a certain percentage, it was either engineering or medicine. You never got to choose, as in, you really never got to choose. Things just happen to you. As in, I don't even know if you ask me, why did you do engineering? I have no idea. As in, because medical was 5 years and engineering was older, that. You know, that's how I'm justified to myself. So it's okay. I think not thinking much is fine. Any other questions? Okay.
Good evening to all of you. Your topic is attracting and engaging the millennials. But you hire from institutions wherein the kind of pedagogy or the kind of, apart from education, the kind of treatment they give is projecting the previous generation values on us. There's not much flexibility when it comes to education institutions.
Yeah.
So isn't it a combined effort of the education institution as well as the corporates? Otherwise, you'll have to do the job all over again when the millennials come to your organizations. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's
a very good question, and you know, you have your professors here, and the partnership between the academia and the industry is extremely vital. For the students to get the flavor of what the corporate or the work life is going to be, and be able to use the energies of the generation far better when you walk into the work. And by the way, there's a lot of work happening on the corporate side to make sure that your transition from academic side is much more smoother in the corporate. And there's a lot of work that is also, I hope, happening on the academic side. But you know, a forum like this is an example, which is giving you a little bit of exposure. It's not too much. 3 days is not possible, not enough. But I'm sure over the 2 years of your post-graduation care, you would have enough interaction that you have.
And by the way, there is a lot of onus on you, on how do you utilize your time. Because if you, we're talking about global mindset. If you were to talk to our B-school students in the US, they are not waiting for the B-school to say, this is the time for you to go do your summer intern. You know, or A is a list of companies, can you write, can you coordinate and writing letters and emails and saying, can you? You know, students are going out, checking out and saying, okay, you are working for IBM, can I come and do a 2 weeks project? You know, a week long project. These are exposures that you need to be seeking out. It is very, it's very good to say what the others are going to do, what the professors and institutions are going to be doing to you. But it is your career, your life. How much investment are you going to make yourself? Going back to the fire in the belly, going back to the fact that there's a, you know, this group is blessed that you have opportunities which did not exist for the parents and this.
Right.
You could choose what you wanted. And if you could do that, if you have, you have chosen to be in HR or you have chosen to be in marketing, what is that you can learn from your, the experience within this room or going out by yourself and getting that?
Sure. And the other things that you talk about, like education system, so one of the things is that, see, how many of you know the word procrastination? Can one of you explain it to me? Show me the raise your hand again, let me see who knew the meaning. How about you? Can you explain to me? What does procrastination mean?
Avoiding the work today and doing it tomorrow.
Yeah, and constant distractions. You can't help it, isn't it? I'm not even blaming your generation. And we, being the, you know, now in work experience and all of that, there's just so much happening technologically that you get distracted. And I think I can see the reason why educational institutes don't allow those you to get your smartphone. It's not that they don't want you to be there. It's not that they don't want you to be technologically savvy. It's because they know for sure that that procrastination will happen. And it's to no fault of yours. It happens to all of us. And maybe there is this, like for example, a lot of schools today have those iPads or something, right, which only run those apps. So maybe there will be a time, I know that IBM is working on Watson, those of you who don't know Watson is Google search. They're working in a lot of education institutes and colleges. And there are certain apps, so for example, their smartphones are the ones that they'll get, will only run those apps which are relevant to their course curriculum. So we are getting there step by step. It's not there yet completely, but it might happen. But then, to Shashank's point,
it's a lonus or license. And so, more addition, you know, in fact, there is a lot of collaboration. I just, shared with you some time back that we had a batch of 25 freshers, you know, who joined in. So, organizations actually thinking a lot about pyramid, people pyramid. So, there it becomes all the more important that, you know, we have freshers like you inducted in the system so that we are able to balance it. And there is a lot of collaboration. We have been, you know, on the World Cafe team. There is a technique, around that theme. We have been, interacting with these freshers and asking them, you know, what their aspirations are. Are those aligned? There is always the complaint always remains that, you know, I wanted to do this, but I am getting to do this. But it is important that, you know, you also align yourself to what is expected out of you. And once you have proven yourself, you can actually, you know, do what you want to do. Because organizations are actually, we are in fact, you know, coming up with so many stretch assignments. And those stretch assignments are basically to cater to your aspirations, those maybe formally have not been met on the job. So there's a lot of collaboration there because we know that, you know, Y generation population anyways is increasing. And it's very important to stay aligned and, you know, set the expectations and meet the expectations for smooth working.
Thank you so much. Any other questions?
That was a very good question.
Yeah, very good one.
Name? I have a question where I have two scenarios in mind. As in one, where automation will take over the things, and on the other, many of the startups which are coming right now growing up and which will be being established in the future. So, my question is that will automation be a hurdle to the startups to grow, or those startups by their innovations will create challenges for the current industry?
Thank you.
It's a very future-oriented question. You like one?
Yeah, automation, yes, it's a reality. How many of you have purchased clothes, electronics online? Yeah, you have an option, right? So yes, automation will be there, but again, just to add to the point that earlier we talked about is we have to adapt to the changes very quickly. Jobs which were not existed 5 years ago, we are talking about it right now, right? You'll never know in the next 5 years what will happen. But it's a reality, you cannot just escape from it. Talking about startups, yes, there are a lot of entrepreneurs who want to make the most of it. But the trick to that, or maybe something that you might want to take away is fail early, fail fast. Right? You just cannot prolong it for, say, 2-3 years. In next 6 months, technology will change. Automation, yes, it's the reality, and we are all going through that phase. Some jobs will be off, some jobs will be created. So how are you trying to upgrade yourself? How are you trying to skill yourself is the key challenge. If you are not in line with that, then nobody can help.
You know, I'm a big believer in the fact that human beings are designed to adapt. And so irrespective of what level of automation comes, we always think ahead and move ahead of that and do more. Think of that. Uber is supposed to be such a big disruptor. You know, it has changed the paradigm of owning ownership of cars and uses of taxis, etc. By the way, Uber itself is under threat now with newer startups coming in the Silicon Valley. Where you know you're no longer talking about cash, you're talking about Kanisha and I and Neetu using our own car, and we're providing platform for you to be able to you know make money out of. So you know that automation, you know, kind of people said it's a death knell for the traditional taxi and cab services. So there's a newer disruption coming in here, and there'll be something more that will come in the time.
In fact, for bigger companies also, one of the things that you said about competition that is bringing in, and I'll accept, as in everybody knows, IBM is going big on cloud, etc. But that didn't come to us from, you know, we came up with that. The moment we realized that a lot of our clients were going to, not even the big companies, they were not leaving IBM and going to a Microsoft. They were leaving IBM and going to this new startup which had come in, and who had like just 20 odd people. Our competitors changed, our entire game plan changed. And then we played catch-up in order to still stay meaningful in the industry. So that's constantly happening. And if you don't change your game again and again and again and again, you'd not survive.
Regarding
there are all eyes on your back, by the way. Don't worry about it. Go ahead. You had a good question before.
Yeah, ma'am. Talking about the cloud, I read something called IaaS, SaaS, and PaaS. As in infrastructure as a service, software as a service, and platform as a service.
Yes.
Can you throw some light on that?
Oh, we want to do another session. We want to throw some light on that. Then you'll start talking about design thinking and agile methodology.
Like. I'll pass because that's a very largest subject.
Yeah.
And may not be of interest to everybody.
So let's do this. You can find each one of us on Twitter. Alright? Put this question again on Twitter. Not only will we answer your question, I will give you some YouTube links to have a look at. It will be like 3 minutes. It will give you what SaaS is, PaaS is, all of those. So you can get all that information. Okay? Alright. I will not ask any more questions now because I think people start moving out of the room now. I understand. Okay, with that we come to a close. Thank you so much. I know 3 days, last session. I think we should give them a very big hand for being such a great audience.
Thank you for the knowledgeable discussion.
May I now call upon Rajesh Bakshi, Student Manager, EITM, to present a memento to Ms. Kanisha Raina.
Thank you.
Manager, BIMHRD.
Okay, one last request. Okay, we're going to take a selfie with the entire audience. Okay, this is the last one, so seem happy. It's over, like the whole thing is over, so you've got to be really excited. Now we're moving a little, so be mindful. The lineup is white. You never know if it was a Facebook live feed, awaaz bhi aata hai.
Student Manager, BIMHRD, to present memento to Mr. Sushant Bhushan. Student Manager, BIMM, to present memento to Mr. Kunjal Kmadar.
Opportunity to thank you all on behalf of Sri Balaji Society. The sole purpose of the 12th National Business Convention 2016 was to get a glimpse into the trending business situations by witnessing the immense knowledge and experience of the corporate stalwarts. On the final day of the convention, I can proudly say that we have successfully achieved that. I would also like to take a moment to thank each and everyone who has been associated with this event in any form and cause which helped in making this event a scintillating success. Their sincere efforts, brilliant hard work, and supportive coordination should be applauded and appreciated. Concluding the event on the third and final day of the National Business Convention, once again, I would like to extend a sincere token of appreciation to all the guests and dignitaries who have enlightened us with their words of wisdom. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.